Sean, the disclaimer on the beginning of your presentation, that's awesome. I think every one of my presentations should have a disclaimer like that. But what I'm going to do today is show you some preliminary results. So I think that's sort of within the theme of this meeting, what we're working on, and maybe inform each other how we can improve those products. And so I'm going to talk with you a little bit about phenology. You know, it's funny, I was talking with someone earlier, and they said phrenology. You know, that's the study of the brain. This is phenology, the study of the timing of changes in vegetation physiology as a result of seasons. So just to get that straight, I am not a brain scientist. And this is work that I've done in conjunction with a graduate student, Catherine White, and then also Paul Schauberg, who's been really instrumental in helping us with that. So, all right, now that I don't even find the podium, how can I actually make it advance? Oh, that's super advanced. Okay, so lots of people do want to study timing of spring leaf out in particular, but also senescence in the fall is of interest, primarily because we all are concerned about climate change. And we know that one of the most immediate responses to temperature, changes in temperature, is that timing of phenology. And so there are all sorts of different ways of looking at that. There are these very intensive sites that are monitored almost every day to see how phenology is changing. Those are great. We have a lot of knowledge about what's going on at those locations, but they're isolated, right? So we also need some way to look at the larger landscape, and that's really where remote sensing technology comes in. But that's not perfect either. The thing I like to mention is that remote sensing gives you a lot of eye candy, really cool pictures, but what does it mean? Is it actually accurate? How can we trust this data? And so that's what we attempted to do with this project, was to link what we can get from these remote sensing coverages, link it to observations in the field so that we can better interpret what those products are telling us. And so in order to do that, and again, this is mostly work that I did with Katie White, we took some Landsat imagery. Landsat circles the globe and returns to the same location every 16 days. And we can take the reflectance data from that, turn it into these vegetation indices, which give you an idea of greenness, right? So you're reflecting this over time. But then how do you turn that into something related to phenology? Well, first you have to figure out how to fit a curve to this data, because obviously the satellite isn't there every single day taking observations. So we have to fill in the gaps in between those observations. And then typically what's done is scientists will come up with some threshold, some index, a vegetation index value, at which they say, oh, something meaningful is happening on the ground. But the problem is that there is no standardized method to do this. It doesn't exist. People who do remote sensing of phenology all do it in a little bit different way. Some use NEBI, some use EBI, some use VI. Some will fit a logistic curve, some will fit a sigmoidal curve, some will use a threshold of 0.3, some will actually look for the inflection point, but lots of different ways. So the point is, we don't know really how to do this well. And that was Katie's job, and she spent 2 years doing that and did come up with what we call the best method. Not that we're biased or anything, but we have now this best method. The thing that's important, and not the details of that method, but really I think the quality control limitations. So being scientists and wanting to be rigorous, we think that no data is better than bad data, right? So we wanted to see, well, what do you do when you have this product? How do you know if you can trust the value that tells you this day, the day of the start of spring? How can we trust that? And Katie came up with a whole bunch of criteria that you can't trust if there aren't at least 5 days over the spring, if you don't have a March baseline, if you don't have July maximum. If you have more than 32 days between images, then you have a problem, and we would actually mask out that data. So we don't see it, we don't trust it. Well, that's really great and sounds all scientifically rigorous, but there are a couple problems, and I'll show you those problems in a second. So our goal, once we have this method, can we apply this to as many images as we can? Can we look then to see if there are temporal trends in phenology over time? Is climate impacting the timing of spring across the state? And then does that change? The change in the timing, is that dependent upon species or elevation or latitude? You know, are all areas equally sensitive to this? So that was the goal. And we focused our study right at the intersection where Landsat Path 13 and Path 14 overlap. And boy, are we lucky, because that happens to be square over Vermont. So it works out well for us. But the reason why we wanted to limit it to that, I mean, it would have been great to look at the entire region. But down here at the bottom, you see image availability. So that's how often the satellite is circling back over us. If we're just using one of those paths, we're not going to get enough image dates to be able to make an accurate prediction. But if we go to the overlap, right, now we have two different double the amount of imagery that's available to us. And that's important because, let me show you a typical Vermont spring. So you can't tell that, but Lake Champlain is hidden under there. I'm moving from March into July, and this is what our sun. Oh, there's one good one. Okay. Oh, there's another good one. Okay. Yeah, so basically out of like 16 opportunities, we have two good images. This was 2009. This is really depressing for someone whose life's work is about studying the terrestrial ecosystem from space. It's hard to do when you can't see it. So I want you to keep this in mind. We are going to apply this method everywhere we can, but what I'm going to show you is not eye candy because it has a lot of blanked out data values. Okay, so when we do apply this, well, this is an example of all the image days and the processing that went into this. So I'm just going to blow through the years now. So here we are predicting the start of spring, so a day of year start of spring across our study area for all of the years that we could, that we had image available, and that is between 1992 and 2012. So you can see, you know, some years have more coverage than others. We blanked out a lot of these because we just couldn't trust that data. Yeah, it's kind of depressing. This is, we're waiting for all the air sand now. Yeah. A good year. This is the one you put up for presentations. Yeah, so just to kind of give you an holy mackerel. No way. That's not right. Really? So this coverage is telling you the darker the red means the more years of imagery we have. Because remember, the goal is to figure out other trends. Have multiple years of data. So where you see a very red color means, ooh, we have, you know, a good amount of years to look at. Where you see the lighter pinks and the whites, it means we can't even look at those areas. We just don't have enough years to really be able to make an assessment. Okay, so what I did now is I said, all right, well, how about this? Show me just the northern forest pixels. We know I have at least 10 years coverage, including these key years that we know we had the most coverage of. So that's the data I'm presenting. It's from this subset of the study area. Okay, so we have pulled out some points. This is mostly max, my GIS gurus are helping with this. Okay, so if we look at the Landsat imagery, that's great, but I realized there weren't a lot of data points there, so I thought let's pull in MODIS too, because you can never get enough data, right? Data overload. So now we have MODIS data as well, which is a wall-to-wall coverage and is there for every single year. But the problem with MODIS is now we're talking about a 250-meter pixel instead of a 30-meter pixel. So our ability to look at sort of maybe these abiotic drivers of trends is a little bit harder, but whatever, we wanted to look at that too and throw that in since we felt that our Landsat coverage wasn't really good enough. And just to give you an idea of how different those look, here's your MODIS product. There's the same area with the Landsat. So we really are losing some of that spatial detail. All right, finally to the results. So what you see at the top in black is the trend in phenology, that start of spring that we see from those Landsat data points, okay? And when I talk about a slope now, we see a negative slope. That means that spring is coming earlier. That's what the negative slope represents. So with a negative slope of 0.4, that means that on average, over those past 20 years, we're increasing by almost half a day every year when the start of spring comes across that study area. So the MODIS data, different data set, different spatial resolution, different area coverage. But what's interesting, look at how similar the trend is between that and the Landsat. So even though I would put that big disclaimer up that we don't really have sufficient coverage with the Landsat, we're seeing the exact same thing with the MODIS. Spring is coming earlier, that's the dotted one. Spring is coming earlier, again, about a half a day earlier each year. That's the general trend. Right? So similar stories. But then again, we need a link to the ground, what's happening on the ground. We want to, you know, validate this. It's not just the satellite seeing this. And so this is where Sandy Wilmot's data set comes in from the Proctor Maple Research Center. They've been looking at sugar maple phenology there again since 92. So that matches our Landsat data set well. So her data, her field data, is now in black. And again, a very similar trend to the orange trend that we're predicting from that Landsat imagery. So it's all telling us the same thing. Even though we can complain about any one of those products and their limitations, together, there's this confluence of evidence. They are saying the same thing. You are indeed seeing a trend, a significant trend at that. Spring is coming earlier as time progresses. Right? So the next question was spatial patterns. Remember, I promised that I want to know, is it changing the same everywhere? Or are there maybe some patterns in where that spring is coming earlier than in other places? With the Landsat data, interestingly, we did find two significant variables. So the lower your elevation and the closer you are to Lake Champlain, the earlier your spring is coming. It's kind of the opposite of what I thought. I thought that maybe upper elevations would be more sensitive, and this representative of our data set, again, preliminary results, but it actually seems the opposite, that places that are sort of inherently warmer are the ones that are changing the fastest, if that makes sense. And then if I use that in a model to try to predict areas of sensitivity, so I would call this sort of phenology, climate sensitivity, the hotspots in red are those areas that we would expect to see phenology changing the most, and the areas in the darker greens are less sensitive. It's just kind of an idea of how you can take information that you get from this and use it to model areas of risk where we should be looking. The MODIS data, boy, again, this is that limitation of the 250-meter imagery. That is an incredibly deep relationship. It's significant, but only because we have so many darn pixels that we can look at. And the only significant variable was latitude. So MODIS is telling us that actually the higher your latitude, the earlier your spring is trending. Not the earlier your spring is, obviously, that doesn't make sense, but the earlier your changes, you're coming sooner and sooner at higher latitudes. So, so rushed, I'm so sorry. But take home messages. You know, we are seeing a change. This is a very clear, I believe, a very clear response to climate change. Right? That we know temperature is changing, and now we have evidence that maybe the response of our forests are also changing in the same way. And what does that mean? I mean, I would like to talk about integration. How can we link that to sort of cascading impacts for ecosystems? Right? Can we pull the in wildlife or insect data sets and see how this is impacting, how they're impacting each other? So I think there's a lot of interesting work that can stem from this, and hopefully we can find some time to talk about that some more.
Have you tried to link that to anything like North Atlantic oscillation or anything?
Oh my gosh, that's a brilliant idea.
Kind of broader climate signal?
No, we need a climate scientist to do that because I couldn't even know where to begin with that. No, but the point that I have noticed that there's huge variability from year to year. I mean, that's the point. There's natural variability, and that's not necessarily a trend. So that's why we need these longer-term data sets, and it would be very interesting to link that to see if there is some sort of a pattern. Yeah.
Jen, what was that
soil forest value? Yeah, that came to Max, my GIS group should be the one to explain that. So this, within the soil survey, in the polygons, they actually have included as an attribute this forest value. And my understanding is the higher the value, the better the nutrient status or the ability to grow forests. So it's vague, it's very vague.
So forest value grew as well?
Yes, yeah, and so that's why I was asking, That's why I was asking if we could use a data set like his as a proxy for nutrient status. And if I could pull something like that in, that might be more informative.